Welcome back into Delmarva Sports Insider. The Shorebirds had a rough go at things this week, guys.
You know what? They already clinched the playoff spot, but when they got so many players moving up and prospects that are actually good, it's kind of hard to sustain the level of play you got when you got guys excelling and moving up to try to continue winning games without some of their top players for the remainder of the season. Wag Your Tail Tuesday at the ballpark.
Who are the doggies?
For the Shorebirds. Getting out of the top of the first, Cody Roberts, great throw to pick off the runner, stealing second. Bottom half of the first, Adam Hall getting the scoring started. Deep shot to left center. That's going to give Delmarva an early 1-0 lead. Now, Hector Guant's on the mound for the Shorebirds. He started the game off strong. No hits allowed, through getting the three batters to go down in the first two innings via the strikeout, keeping the Shorebirds up 1-0. But he would begin to struggle in the third inning. I've never seen this before, guys. This guy struck out 3 and 2 innings and then walked 4 straight the next inning. That's why it's the minor leagues. 2-1 game, Carlos De La Cruz turning on one to give the Blue Claws another big lead. The Shorebirds battle back late, but the Blue Claws hold on to win this one by a final of 7-4.
All right, next night after a scoreless first, a routine fly ball to center. Nick Horvath makes the play. Now, he tries to get the runner tagging to third,
minor league baseball,
but the ball goes into the dugout, exactly, and Lakewood takes a 1-0 lead. All right, next inning, McCarthy Tatum at the dish for the Blue Claws, and he smokes a ball into left, leaves the park in less than 4 seconds, so 2-0, the Shorebirds already trail. As a matter of fact, they didn't get a hit until, or their first hit, until the fourth inning. Robert Nystrom singles to center, but next batter, Ryan Ogren, goes 6-4-3, so tough night for the bats on offense for the Shorebirds. Now, this was, no doubt, the play of the game. Jonathan Guzman hits a liner to right. Nystrom can't make the catch, so it goes all the way to the wall. Guzman hustling around. Yeah,
he should be out.
But Guzman gets under before Ben Brazil can get the tag down. The rain would come down, forcing this one to end early. Shorebirds, they go down 4-0 in 6 innings.
Trey, you asked me how I've seen it before. I have seen it in high school and little league ball because they teach you, and I teach my kids this on the weekend. When you put the tag, you put the tag down in front of the plate. There's a reason why you get the glove down, because they can't get to the plate if you have your glove there.
Yeah.
Minor league baseball.
Exactly.
That's
right.
Where you learn.
I called it. And as good as the Shorebirds have looked this season, you kind of start seeing some things when some of those prospects are moving on up. And they've lost 4 of 6. They lost 4 of 6 in that homestand. Like I said, really hard to win. The good thing is they got 2 wins yesterday and tonight against the West Virginia Power to kind of get that losing streak off their backs.
And I think you kind of nailed it on the head. I don't think it's complacency, you know, whatsoever. I think, you know, you have 60 wins in the first half, and then all of a sudden you come back, you clinch the postseason, but that's not it. They lose a lot of offensive pieces in the last few days, which is difficult. Of course, exactly. And he hit a home run earlier this week as well. So it's certainly very difficult. Ben Brazil, quick note, probably staring at our 47 ABC logo out there in left field. That's probably what it was.
That's what it was.
Just saying.
And the thing is, it's not over yet. As the season continues, the summer goes on, more call-ups expected. Yeah. So,
playoffs coming.
At least we'll have playoffs, right?
Yeah. What's going to happen in the playoffs, though, with all these guys gone?
We'll pitching.
We will see.
There you go. All right. Now to a story in Delaware where the state champion Laurel Little League Major softball team, and this is a heartbreaker, left in tears after they were suddenly disqualified from playing in a regional tournament. 47 ABC's Taylor Lumpkin has more.
They've worked so hard for this, and to have it pulled out at the last minute away from them it's difficult.
13 girls with a dream of playing in the Little League Major Regionals in Connecticut and a chance to go to Nationals are now faced with a harsh reality.
He told us, and I was like, I really just like wanted to cry right there.
The night before leaving for Regionals, the state champion Laurel Little League Major softball team got some devastating news. Their team was being disqualified after the Little League International Tournament Committee found that one of their players lived outside of the Laurel district boundary.
We had everything packed. We were about to get everything ready. Just to know that we worked as hard as we did to win this, it's just very upsetting to know that we got disqualified.
But we're told that teammate had been playing with the league for years, and the issue never came up before.
She's been playing with us since she was 4, and she went last year with us, and they never said anything.
That's where I'm really struggling, is how Little League approved her 1 year, and not the next.
But despite the heartbreaking news, this team is still rallying behind one another and are letting their resilient spirits shine through.
We know she felt responsible for it. She said, "I'm sorry, guys, for whatever I did." And we all were just like, "It's not your fault."
I think that's why it's so devastating. You give, you know, blood, sweat, and tears. And you do everything right. I mean, everything. You walk on the field with integrity, respect.
Taylor Lumpkin, 47 ABC.
Now, in a statement from Little League, they say because of the disqualification, a team from Newark is playing in regionals instead. And that decision from the Little League International Tournament Committee is final and binding. But I want to talk about this. It's a tough one for the girls, right? Because Coach said she was able to play last year. So I understand that, but I also get a rule is a rule. You know where these players live. She's outside of the boundaries. So you're almost begging not to get caught.
It's one of those tough things where they say, hey, you know, she played with us last year. She's been playing with us forever. So, you know, what is right or wrong? If you know, I mean, I don't know if this is something you could report or something that you could say, hey, you know, I just want to make sure everybody knows, you know, this is what's going on. But ultimately, like I said with the Mardella story, the kids are the one that lose in this. You have to be heartbroken for those young ladies, especially that we're able to get on camera and say, you know, as hard as we worked, it's not happening for us.
And that's who you think about in this situation. Coaches should know what the rules are. You know, of course, parents should know what the rules are. Just because you were able to play in previous seasons does not mean that you are entitled to play this year. The girls worked extremely hard. They need to focus on softball, not focus on where they need to be living and whatnot.
I don't even know if it's you should be just because you were allowed to play last year doesn't mean you're allowed to play this year. It seems like that rule was in place for a while, and it seems like for some reason they were just able to skate over it. Maybe somebody missed looking at that address there.
We talked about this in the story. Ultimately, the rule is the rule.
It's a rule. You know what I mean? But it's tough, and you would have liked to see if there was a way that
a
maybe
resolution.
Just take her off the roster.
Yeah.
Take her off the roster and let those girls play.
Something.
But, you know, that's the bad side of sports, right?
I agree, but you know what? That serves as a life lesson.
There we go.
Not everything is always what it seems, right?
That's true.
All right, guys, we shift our gears now to some college news. Salisbury University unveiling their 2019 football schedule on Wednesday afternoon. You know I was giddy for this one, guys. There's my guy, Coach Sherman Wood, the man.
Sure, he's strutting.
Exactly. The Gauls open up their season on the road Friday, September 6th at Albright. We're going to win that game. Weeks 2 and 3. Our home against a pair of first-time opponents. 2019 home opener, September 14th. Yes, I did, Sean Carroll. You're a bad man. Against Wisconsin Oshkosh. And then Salisbury takes on Central International on September 21st. Now, after a bye week, a pair of familiar foes back in the Bury, October 12th. Route 13 rival Wesley in week 6 and Rowan in next week for homecoming. The final home game of the season, November 2nd, against CNU for Senior Day. Well, the 2018 team finished with an 8-3 overall record in their 15th straight postseason bid.
All right, up in Dover, the Wesley College Wolverines also released their 2019 schedule. This week. The Dub has four home games this season, but opened the year with three straight road trips.
That's
the opener is Saturday, September 7th in New Hampshire, as Wesley takes on Division II foe Franklin Pierce. The first home game of the year does not come until Saturday, October 5th, when Wesley plays host to Rowan.
They will travel,
we mentioned it, to rival Salisbury the following week and won't play another home contest until the 26th of October when Montclair State travels to Dover. Two home games end the year with Keene and Christopher Newport also coming to town in the second and third weekends of November. Wesley finished 7-4 a season ago, their first since the passing of legendary head coach Mike Drass. That was also their worst record since the year 2003. So look for a much needed turnaround for the Dub in their second year under head coach Chip Knapp.
And Trey, I know we got another story to talk about, but do you think Knapp has some words with the AD after taking a look at that schedule?
Man, look, all I'm going to say is you got two home games in the first 8 weeks of the season.
Right.
That is not good.
It's not good.
I don't know. Your season could be over by the time you get back to Dover.
Especially
you know
for a team looking to turn things around after a down year last year.
All right, on to our last. That's a very good point. Last news scoop comes from a guy that probably could play for Wesley or Salisbury right now. Delmar standout junior Dante Trader Jr. announced yesterday morning via Twitter that he would be leaving his home school, transferring to McDonough in Owings Mills. Guys, look at this highlight. I cut this, so I want you to look at it. All right, McDonough's a private college prep school regarded as one of the most prestigious preparatory schools in the entire Baltimore region. And Trader is a standout in lacrosse and football. He spent 3 years at Del Mar High School. Let's run off his resume. Eighth grade year, started on the varsity basketball team. He won a football state championship his freshman year with the Wildcats. And this past season was an all-state standout on both the football and lacrosse field. So in 3 years, what else do you do?
You know what?
What else can you accomplish, literally?
There's talk about things that you want to do in high school, right?
Yeah.
You know, before you leave.
Yeah.
You want to leave a legacy.
Yeah.
He's already left it there, so I know
he's
heartbroken to leave Delmar, and Delmar's heartbroken to lose him, but what else can you ask of the kid?
Nothing.
He also won the state championship as a freshman with the football team after the quarterback went down,
and he
asked him to be the starting quarterback, and they were the last seed in the playoffs, and they had to go on the road the entire playoffs.
Bye, Dante.
Yeah.
Well-deserved.
Well-deserved. Well-deserved.
You don't need it.
Yeah.
And the world is, I'm sure, anxious to see what Dante has next, because it's going to be a lot of excellence.
Absolutely.
All right, when we return, what police department is determined to make this year's National Night Out a huge success? We'll tell you after the break.
It's Macy Griffin from Washington High, and you're watching Del Mar Sports Insider.